Hello friends, welcome to Pioneer of Success, an online free educational institute. So we are continuing with the WBCS chemistry series, and today is the lecture number 2, and we'll be discussing on quantum numbers of electrons. So today's topic is quantum number of electrons. So before going into details of the quantum number, let me tell you something about myself. I'm Shishir Mitro, a researcher of Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. So I have been making videos on Indian polity, Indian national movement, and now I'm making videos on chemistry, and upcoming days I'll be making more videos so that you can get everything from my channel. If you are preparing for WBCS, if you are preparing for engineering examinations and all. So now let me pause it. So suppose you have an atom, so there you have nucleus. At the center you have nucleus, and nucleus is consisting of your proton plus electron. Proton plus neutron. So in nucleus, what do you have? You have proton and neutron. And after that, you have so many shells. That is, this is neutron and proton, that is nucleus. And after that, you have many shells. And in our class 9 chemistry, we have learned this is K, L, M, N, or we consider it 1, 2, 3, 4. That is called principal quantum number. So initially we were not aware of other quantum numbers. We were only aware of the principal quantum numbers, and the rule of electron configuration was 2 into n square. What does it mean? If n is the principal quantum number, so if you have n equal to 1, then you have 2 into 1 square electron. That means only 2 electron. Clear? Then in shell number 2, you put 2 dot 2 square. That means 4 into 2 is 8 electron. So in shell number 2, you have 8 electrons. Like that in shell number 3, you have 2 into 3 square. 3 squares mean 9 into 2, 18 electrons. So here you have 18 electrons. So likewise, it will be continuing, but you remember more than 32 electrons in a shell is not possible, and the last shell is considered as valence shell, and in valence shell you cannot expect more than 8 electrons, and those are the limitations you should know. Okay, so that was all about principal quantum number and basic electronic configuration and number of electrons in a shell. But now you have to understand there are many quantum numbers for a single electron. What does it mean? It means you have nucleus in the outermost, say this is the outermost shell, you have 2 electrons. Now these 2 electrons, I consider this is the A electron and this is the B electron. Now A electron will have 4 different quantum numbers, and likewise B also have 4 different quantum numbers. And according to the Pauli's exclusion principle, there are no two electrons in an atom that will have all the quantum numbers equal. What is the explanation? I'll be covering in the upcoming videos, but for the time being you understand there are no two electrons in an atom that would have all the quantum numbers equal. Now each electron has four different quantum numbers. Now what are those quantum numbers? Those are principal quantum numbers, those are azimuthal quantum numbers, those are magnetic quantum numbers and spin quantum number. So you can note down, first one is principal quantum number, second one is azimuthal quantum numbers, third one is your magnetic quantum number, and the fourth one is your spin quantum number. Now suppose this is the nucleus and this is the first shell. In this first shell, in each and every shell you have sub shells. Okay, so for n equal to 1, that is if the principal quantum number is 1, so you consider this electron, a electron, it has principal quantum number p equal to say 1. Now another quantum number you have, that is called l or azimuthal quantum number. Now if p is L would be always, mod of L would be always less than n. What does it mean? If n is equal to 1, then L cannot be 1. L would be 0. If n equal to 2, then L cannot be equal to 2. L can be equal to 0, L can be equal to 1, L can be equal to minus 1, but it cannot be equal to 2. So mod of L is always less than n, or you can say L is always less than n, whatever you feel better. Okay, now for n equal to 1, that means when your principal quantum number is 1, then you have only one possibility, that is L is 0. Clear? And if 0, so when L is 0, we tell it s orbital. When l is 1, we call it p orbital. When l is 2, we call it t orbital. And when l is 3, we call it f orbital. And likewise, it continues. So, again, I'm telling this n equal to 1 would give you L equal to 0, one and only value is 0, and 0 means S. The first S is the significance of this 0. If L is 0, then it would be S. Now what does this 1 signify? This 1 signifies this principal quantum number. So when I say 1 S, I get two information from this 1 S. The first one is, this 1 means your principal quantum number is 1. And the second information which we can decipher from here is S means your L equal to 0. So those two information I now have. Okay. Now there are many possibilities for L. Under a shell you have shaft shells or orbitals, whatever you call it. S is an orbital. Likewise, you can have p orbitals. As I have told earlier, that l equal to 1, that means your p orbital, l equal to 2, that means your d orbital. Now for a specific value of n, you have 2l plus 1 values of l. What does it mean? Suppose you have n equal to 2. Now n equal to 2, you have L max equal to 1, because I told L is always less than n. So for n equal to 2, the maximum value of L is 1. Now whenever you are calculating 2L plus 1 number, you should consider the maximum value of L. Now for n equal to 2, L maximum value of L is equal to 1. So 2L plus 1 is coming your 3, right? You understood? So 12 plus 1 is now coming 3. So you have 3 possibilities. Now what are those possibilities? So now you have 3 different values of L, and those are minus L, 2 plus L. Are you understanding? Minus L means maximum value of L for n equal to 2, I have already told, is 1. So minus L means minus 1. Minus 1 and plus L means 1, so it would be continuing from minus 1 to plus 1, so the middle value is 0. So those are 3 L or 3 orbitals. Now minus 1, that is your px, I can say. 0 you can say py, L you can say pz. What does it mean? L equal to 1, or maximum value of L equal to 1, that signifies a p orbital or azimuthal p. Now there are 3 different orbitals of p. those are px, py and pz. Now px means say minus 1, py means say l equal to 0 and pz means l equal to 1. So you have for this two, you have two different possibilities of l, 0 and 1. Your 0 means s, as I have already told. P means your P, or sorry, 1 means your P. Now here in 0 you have only 2s orbital, in P you have 2p orbital, but 2p has minus 1, 0 and 1. It would be given by 2px, 2py and 2pz. Are you understanding? In 2s we have only one orbital, but in 2p we have three orbitals, px, py and pz, and those are given by 1, 0 and minus 1. It is the convention. If I say plus 1 is x, 0 is y, minus 1 is pz, so likewise. So how many p orbitals are there? 0, 1 and minus 1. So you have three p orbitals, px, py and pz. And this is called magnetic quantum number. This px, py and pz is called your magnetic quantum number. Okay. So this value is 3. Now, how many total orbitals you have under this 2? Under this 2 you have 1 2s orbital and 3 p orbital. So you have totally 4 orbital. Now, we went up to px, py and pz. So now we know the principal quantum number is 2, azimuthal quantum number is 0 and 1. 0 means 2s, we know 1 means p and it is 2p. And in 2p also you have 3 magnetic quantum numbers, that is 1, 0 and minus 1. So this l equal to minus l to plus l, those are called magnetic quantum numbers. So when l equal to 1, you have 3 magnetic quantum numbers, 1 is minus 1, 0 and 1. Okay. Now each of this magnetic quantum number has two different spin quantum number. That means in this orbital you have probability of having two electrons, say electron A and electron B. If the electron A rotates in the positive direction, that means clockwise, then B would obviously rotate in anticlockwise. And if I consider positive direction rotation as plus half, the negative or anticlockwise direction would be minus half. So now in Px, again you have two electrons, and two electrons would be distinguished by only the principal quantum, only the this quantum number, which is called your spin quantum number. So up to this point, suppose I have a, let me explain in a better way, suppose I have a Px orbital. So in Px, say this is 2Px. So I have this electron and that electron. So now considering this electron, what would be the principal quantum number? This is 2. What would be your, for Px, what would be your L? L would be 1. What would be your M? This is L. M would be 1. Now another quantum number you have S, say this is moving in the clockwise direction, and I consider it at as plus half. Okay, now plus half, I consider this electron. Again this electron would have principal quantum number 2, L is again 1, M is again 1, because same Px, but S would be minus half. Clear? So you can see these three quantum numbers for both the cases are same. Only the spin quantum numbers are different. So that is the Pauli's exclusion principle, that two electrons That means these are two different electrons residing in an atom, single atom. Both the electrons cannot have all the quantum numbers same. So you can understand now, three quantum numbers are same, but this is not same. So overall, set of quantum numbers are different. So you cannot have two electrons which would have all the quantum numbers same. So that is the Pauli's exclusion principle. It essentially means an orbital would contain maximum two electrons. Clear? So thank you very much for watching this video. I'll be uploading more videos on chemistry. So please subscribe to my channel. These videos would be helpful for your preparation. And please tell your friends to subscribe to my channel so that I can get inspiration for making new videos. Thank you very much.